There was a fascist website called the Iron March, which is now defunct, but it published articles and literature on modern fascism. Apparently, according to Wikipedia, not the best source, the website was set up by a Russian guy, and some of its members killed each other, with one guy killing a Sikh. So this is, or was, a genuine modern fascist group. Well, they published a PDF titled Fascist Economics and Socialism of Duty. And what I want to do today is run through it and give you an analysis to see if anything has really changed since 1945, which is the era I've studied extensively on this channel. Has fascism evolved over time? Are there any differences? And is there any evidence to support my ongoing hypothesis that fascism is a form of the religion known as Gnosticism? First things first, I've previously outlined the difference between fascism and National Socialism, and there are big differences. But that was in the pre-1945 era, outside of Britain, where there was some confusion. While wanting to get closer to Hitler, Mussolini assigned Julius Evola, a non-fascist fascist who was a nutjob, to unite the two ideologies together. He didn't succeed during the war, but it appears, based on the fact that there is a Nazi symbol in the background, the swastika, while the text is clearly talking about fascist economics, Evola may have succeeded here, but it depends, because there was some confusion before, so I'm curious to know if this is just National Socialism with the word fascism slapped onto it, or if they have genuinely brought fascism and National Socialism together. And this author does quote from Julius Evola a lot, and Evola's influence is felt throughout the text, so let's read the first bit.
One of the most plagued questions we get when talking about fascism is economics, normally brought up by people still stuck in a liberal mentality and limited scope of perception, where everything is defined in terms of social and economic policies, rather than principles derived from the notion of a singular truth and order that dominates the world.
There's actually a lot to unpack here straight away. Fascists believe that liberalism is the cause of all the degeneracy in the world. So the right liberals believe in freedom to the individual, you can do whatever you want so long as you do not harm others, they take responsibility for their actions, they want to own property and their own businesses, they want to be able to trade without a commissar pointing a gun at their face, they want to be free from the oppression of the state, hence the word liberal. The so-called left liberals believe that you should identify as a group, and when they get the next Stalin into power, you'll be pride marched straight into the gulags. They don't see the Orwellian doublespeak from the left as propaganda, they just believe in it. So there are no left liberals, they don't believe in freedom, they believe in state oppression. But the point is that the fascists don't see through the lies of the left, and have falsely identified them as being liberal. So, from a fascist point of view, liberalism is the cause of all the degeneracy in the world. Now, where is the source for what I've just explained? Normally, I list my sources at the bottom of the screen, this one's just an example, so that you know that I'm not just making stuff up. But here, I didn't do that, and the reason why is because my source is a YouTuber who is a third positionist. He has explained this fairly well, however, I cannot list him as a source because I haven't had time to watch all of his videos yet, and I selfishly don't want his channel to be mass flagged and deleted. You know, I can't control what my audience will do, but as much as we may not like them, I don't want them silenced because we can't learn from them if they're silenced. Anyway, you'll just have to take my word for it that I have a source for the liberalism equals degeneracy thing. And this YouTuber actually explains it really well. But now we can see why the author of the Iron March text says people stuck in a liberal mentality cannot perceive the higher truth and order. He later refers to it as a cosmic order, by the way. But why does he put truth and order in capital letters? Because the singular truth is the singular God. Truth is God, and order, or cosmic order, is the order of the true God. This is a religion. They know more about God, Gnosis, than the people still stuck in the liberal mentality with limited scope and perception, the liberals. So left versus right, they're using the dialectic to get to the higher truth, Thus, they are third positionists, and are moving higher towards God. This is a Gnostic denomination. And I've got several sources for Gnosticism. I've already done videos on National Socialism being Gnosticism, so there's plenty of explanation and sources in there. And as we read through this text, we're going to see a lot more evidence for it.
The variety of historic economic plans and practices maintained by various champions of our struggle likewise distorts any comprehensive answer to the question.
The word struggle is what Hitler uses a lot. It goes all the way back to Heraclitus in ancient Greece. And the struggle is actually an alternative description of the dialectical method. In the dialectic, you have a thesis and antithesis, then you have a negation or struggle, which results in the revolution of thought, which is the synthesis. So the word struggle, especially when it comes with a capital S, is an indication that you're dealing with a dialectic. The Marxists use the same phrase as well, and in this context, it also simultaneously means our natural struggle in the world for evolution and survival of the fittest, etc. But that is the materialist interpretation of the world. That's how the common man will interpret it. But the fascist priests are using the word differently. They mean it as the struggle to get to God. So again, this is a religion.
All in all, we've simply answered people that economics are secondary. They don't matter as such in a way as to be a fundamental and defining element of fascism.
This is Hitler's primacy of politics idea. In a free market, economics dictates the actions of man, but in politics, man dictates the actions of man. So for Hitler, politics must take primacy over economics. The economics must be subservient to the whims of the state, state control of the means of production. They cannot leave it up to nature to dictate what's right and wrong. The central planners decide what's best for all of us.
The answer didn't change. However, there is now a way in which we can describe this attitude to economics, and it's actually a word we've used repeatedly in reference to fascism anyway. Socialism. Our socialism, however, is not in and of itself an economic system. It is not the socialism of Marx and Co., and stands in direct opposition to both communism and capitalism. It would be more accurate to say that, to fascism, socialism is the definitive social structure, which is more comparable to the structures of individualism and collectivism, yet it stands in opposition to those two structures as well.
Again, they're not communists nor capitalists. They're not individualists nor collectivists. They are higher than that. They are third positionists, and therefore dialectic. They say they are socialists, but they're not Marxist socialists. They're something else. And they say socialism is not just economic, it's something else, which is nonsense it is. They never define socialism. They never define it. Just like the Marxists don't define it. And the reason why is because they know. You don't know, but they know. They're smarter than you because they have divine knowledge. They are the priestly class. You're just a peasant. They have secret knowledge, and if you want to know the secret knowledge, you must join the cult. This is the esoteric nature of the secret society. Esoteric basically meaning secret. I'll put the full definition on the screen. It's a way of tricking you into the cult. You're curious to know what the super truth really is, so you start to trust them, you start to read their literature, you start to join in then on their discussions, and they exploit your curiosity so that you end up falling into the wizard circle. Anyone grounded in individualism, logic and reason probably won't fall for this, but the impressionable teenager who hasn't got a firm grip of the world, who is looking to develop their personality and is trying to understand their place in the world, are perfect prey for this sort of tactic. That's why the left is so keen about education, education, education. Why did Tony Blair care about that so much? Well, it's because young people are the easiest to indoctrinate. Hitler said the same thing in Mein Kampf. Most people become socialists when they're young and then grow out of it later when they realise that they've been tricked. That's where the red pill comes from. You come out of the Matrix and you see the world for how it really is. So, fascism and socialism cannot be defined because as soon as it is, you know what it is and therefore can start questioning it. They also reinterpret the idea of collectivism to mean,
collectivism is individualism seeking strength in numbers on given common interests.
No, it isn't. Collectivism isn't individualism. That's nonsense. You're either an individual or a group. You can't be both. But they confuse you with their doublespeak, so like a deer in headlights, you get curious, you want to know the truth, so you join the cult. And in fact, the third positionist YouTuber I can't mention said that they are national collectivists. He used that term, national collectivists. So they don't believe in individualism, they believe that you're part of the group, the race. If it's survival of the fittest and you're competing to pass on your genes to the next generation, then who are you competing against? A cat and a dog cannot breed together, so when the cat wants to pass on its genes, it's not competing with dogs, it's competing with other cats. You're competing with the other members of your race. Thus, you're not working towards your race, you're working against it. This is a collectivist ideology that believes we should all work towards our race, yet to believe in race, you have to believe in the survival of the fittest idea, but if you believe in that idea, you're competing against your own race, and thus there is no race collective. The whole ideology falls apart in a big contradictory mess. But this is where the dialectic comes in. They embrace contradictions because they think contradictions bring them closer to the true God. And again, it's nonsense. In the real world, when you've got a contradiction, it means you've got something wrong. But by embracing contradictions, this Orwellian doublethink shuts down your ability to think, and therefore you become a drone in their cult. You don't think, you just follow the leader, the Führer. So it's just a trick.
Going back to the quote, collectivism is individualism seeking strength in numbers on given common interests. I'm fairly certain that strength in numbers probably means something deeper than what it appears to be, but I haven't figured that out yet, so moving on. Comparatively speaking, one could argue that collectivists get more S done than individualists, because the victory of a collective influences the outcome for every participant of the collective, and they are all somewhat elevated, whereas in individualism, all victories are individual, and few people achieve them.
Paradoxically, history shows, as does reality, that individualism achieves more than collectivism. The fact that these people cannot fathom this is proof in the pudding that they do not understand basic economics. They have not read Economics in One Lesson by Henry Hazlitt or Basic Economics by Thomas Sowell. The literature is out there explaining this, but they haven't done their homework, so they're just making the exact same assumption that every socialist and every collectivist does. But again, collectivists do not achieve more. So yeah, maybe fewer people achieve things, but that's because in order to achieve something, you have to put effort in. Why would you put effort in if you think you're being exploited? Which is what society teaches us. In reality, everyone can achieve victories, but you have to see the world differently than the way that the collectivists teach it.
Moreover, in individualism, absolutely every single other individual is a competitor, even when you struggle for the same prize. Whereas in collectivism, everyone within the collective ideally shares in the victory.
But you don't? One, this is not how free markets and individualism works, and you're only assuming this because you haven't done your homework. And two, you're being hypocritical because fascists believe in the survival of the fittest thing, right? You cannot have a collective where we all share in the victory whilst having the survival of the fittest thing. So this is where they'll argue that they're not Darwinists, they're social Darwinists. So it's not survival of the fittest individual, it's survival of the fittest race. It's dogs versus cats. You know, all the dogs are working together, all the cats are working together, and they're just struggling against each other rather than struggling against themselves. So it's pseudoscience. You know, it's a religion. In reality, dogs don't compete against cats for the passing on of their genes, they compete against other dogs. Yes, cats and dogs do fight against each other sometimes, but often they work together. But the point is that to pass on their genes, dogs are competing against other dogs, not cats. So it's the survival of the fittest individual, not collective. It's Darwinism, not social Darwinism. There are no groups, there are only individuals. But fascists, Nazis and Marxists reject the idea of the individual, so they can't accept this. Plus, collectivism doesn't result in everybody sharing the victory. It results in everybody sharing the starvation. Collectivism doesn't work. Socialism doesn't work. Without free market prices, you cannot have economic calculations. You cannot know what's happening in the economy because you've not got any way to measure it. It's the equivalent of trying to get to the moon without using mathematics. It's just not going to happen. Your religion has rejected mathematics, the free market, because you don't understand it. You think it's greedy and materialism and some other religious excuse, but it's not. It's the calculator. You're throwing out the calculator because you don't understand how it works and you think it's black magic. If you throw out the free market and individualism, you'll get poverty and starvation. It happens every single time. We're seeing it right now because as we reject these principles, the economy starts to falter. The more we embrace collectivism, the worse things get. That's not a coincidence. And so, we won't be sharing in the victory at all. We'll be sharing in the defeat. Now, in this next section, they're going to argue that they're not collectivists, with a capital C, which means communists. Instead, they're a combination of collectivism and individualism. They're the third position. But, as the YouTuber I can't name says, they're national collectivists, with individualism slapped on the side. So don't be fooled by their doublethink. Yes, they're not Marxists, and they're not free market guys, but they are collectivists.
Ultimately, however, both individualism and collectivism are no good for fascism, as their fundamental premise is individual interest, regardless if it is pursued individually or collectively. Again, this confirms what the third positionist YouTuber said. Everything that's not fascism is liberalism, and liberalism leads to degeneracy because of individual interest or selfishness. We've covered before how interests are always selfish and self-serving, going against any kind of order, in favour of one's own mere whims and wants, which are always material and inevitably lead to degeneracy.
So again, order is God. If you're selfish, you're against God, since you should be working towards the true God. Materialism is bad, because materialism was created by the devil, or demiurge. The demiurge creates the material realm and is the prison for the soul of man, and that leads to degeneracy. So your goal, as the Gnostics will tell you, is to transcend the material realm to get to the true God behind the demiurge. So by being selfish, you're being material, which is embracing the demiurge. You're going against God, and that's why you're a degenerate, which is basically the devil. You're a Satanist, essentially. And I don't know if fascists realize that they're in a religious cult. Maybe some do, but I think the majority probably don't realize it. But the third positionist YouTuber I mentioned actually refers to their national collectivism as ethical socialism. He says in one video, if you deconstruct everything, hierarchies and so on, you're left with the will, the soul, as the moral good, confirming that it's religion, and that he's fighting for the soul of man. He says the right argues that the free market is the way to get to transcendence, apparently, while the left argues socialism is the best way to get to transcendence. He says it's all negative, and that the left and right have to tear everything down in order to get to their freedom. He admits that there is an ethic beneath it, but he disagrees with it, and he basically says that the third positionists build upwards using the state, and they get to God by using the state to transcend. You know, I really wish I could show what his video was talking about. So I do think some third positionists realize that they're in a cult, but I also suspect that many do not know this. You know, I look at the left and I know that most of them don't realize that they're trying to transcend to get to the true God. They just kind of go with the motions because it feels like the right thing to do. So I can imagine that many fascists or whatever are doing the same. It's harder to tell though because they're suppressed so much. But from what I've seen, I get that impression. So it'll be interesting to see how the fascists and Nazis react to this video, because I do get some watching this stuff, and I've gotten through to some of them and pulled them out and away from their ideology. So it'll be interesting to see if I can do that again.
Moreover, neither individualism nor collectivism does anything to preserve one's personhood. An issue of semantics. I'm using personhood and personality to give different and untainted term to what is commonly referred to as individuality and identity. To be an individual merely means to be a digit, an atom. To be a collective means to be a cog. In both instances, personhood is not valuable. Atoms are just as replaceable as cogs and just as lacking in any real personality. Only difference is the less rigid structure of individualism, where you can maintain the illusion of being your own person, while walking in a sea of clones who can replace you at a moment's notice, because both individualism and collectivism work on the premise of equality, and necessitate easy replaceability. In both instances, personality can be sacrificed, either for a collective mentality or a fake marketable individual identity.
People who believe in free markets do not believe in equality. I am not equal to you, and you are not equal to me. We're all different. So the fact that he says that individualism works on the premise of equality shows his ignorance. He's looking at this world with his collectivist goggles on, whilst pretending not to be a collectivist. He then says that individuality is a fake individuality, and they're marketing identity as a substitute for real individuality. I agree that the group identity that the left are coming out with is marketable, but you know, that's because there are no groups, there are only individuals. But anyone who advocates for a free market and then individualism, that's not a fake identity. Once you've got a clear sense of self, once you stop self-sacrificing for others and put yourself first, which is how you develop yourself and grow as a person, that's not a fake identity. So the fact that he's saying this shows that he's got no idea of the world outside of the collectivist bubble.
Thus, you can see how the social structure of individualism coincides with the economic system of capitalism, and the social structure of collectivism with the economic system of communism. Both capitalism and communism seek the same, material prosperity.
No, they don't. Communists don't seek material prosperity at all. Their dialectic pretends that they do, but in reality they actually want to destroy the material. They want to get to the true God behind the demiurge, just like the third positionists do. But these are competing denominations of the same religion. So just like Protestants and Catholics are competing for the soul of man, so are fascists and Marxists. It's like, no, they're the heretics, we are the real people's front of Judea. So the third positionists are saying that the Marxists are for material prosperity, when in reality they're anything but that. They are dialectical materialists. Dialectic is transcendence, so they're trying to transcend materialism, hence the term dialectical materialism, transcending materialism. The fact that they're saying otherwise proves that they're either lying or they've got no idea what they're on about.
Communism, all in all, is a direct product of individualism and capitalism during the Industrial Revolution. Of course it is, my dear, and here come the men in little white coats to take you away. Communism simply becomes the pursuit of capitalist goals without the bourgeoisie to stand in the way of the proletariat. Yep, that's exactly what it is. But that doesn't mean communism is individualism. It's not. The goal of capitalism is ultimately to work and make profit until such a point where you don't have to work. Work is an obstacle to be overcome on the path to having material wealth that can be enjoyed, and thus decadence sets in.
I'm going to make the distinction between capitalism and the free market. If you think these are one and the same, then we don't have capitalism because we don't have a free market. Free market people are not for the corporations or the state, or the landed gentry. Free market people are for the self-employed worker, the mom-and-pop's business owner, the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker. And the idea isn't to make profit so that we don't have to work. It's not about decadence and material wealth. It's about overcoming poverty. The natural state of the universe is death. To overcome death and poverty, you produce your own wealth, then you trade it with others in order to better your position. Now, maybe you'll get to a point where you can retire and relax or whatever, but the reason you're working is to stave off poverty. Profit just indicates that you're not making a loss, that you're not becoming poorer. The fact that I have to explain that basic concept, this really basic idea of economics, is like, it's unbelievable that I have to explain that. But that's the problem when you're talking to cultists. It's those people who have no skills, no drive, no ambition, no will, or no idea who will end up in poverty. And if you don't understand what the free market is, this, what the Marxists and the fascists believe in, will be your outlook. You will not understand it and you'll be poor. You will complain about materialism and decadence and, you know, as a cope for the fact that you're failing to make something of yourself.
It should be obvious by now that fascism does not seek material wealth as a goal in of itself, regardless if it is for individuals or a collective.
So they're not going to make any profit? They're just going to fail? That's what this sentence means. They don't understand basic economics.
Moreover, fascism, striving to make human society coincide with the cosmic order and the truth, does not favour obscurification of one's personhood, but to the contrary, wants to develop it to its full potential, which is different for every man, based on their place within the cosmic order.
It's a good idea we don't use profit and loss to show who's higher or lower in the cosmic order, otherwise you guys will be on the rock bottom. We don't need you to rearrange society. We don't need a cosmic order. We just need you to get a job. But Mom, I can't get a job because I need to figure out how to get to the truth. Shut up, stop making excuses, and get to work.
Our goal, in short, is creating the organic state where everyone is in their rightful place, striving to realize themselves, and in doing so, contribute to the realization of the nation and of the ultimate truth.
So yes, this is a cult. Truth is their god. It's the true god behind the demiurge. But the larger point they're trying to make here with this and the previous quote is that, you know, it actually goes back to Giovanni Gentile, the philosophical founder of fascism. Gentile said that a person cannot become a fully fleshed human being unless the state creates the conditions to allow this to happen. So it's kind of like, who's going to build the roads? Only the state can build the roads, even though that's not true, but they believe it is. So who's going to build you? Only the state can build you, right? So collectivists genuinely believe that only the state can create you, because you are the product, the offspring, of the Church of God, the state. Now, he's specifically referring to the organic state. That's what the fascists refer to this as, and Giovanni Gentile did as well. In their conception, the state is a living body, a superorganism. Hence organic. So you are a cell in this superorganism, and we must all work together for the whole. And what is this whole? God. Once we, the shards or cells of this almighty being, come together as a collective whole, the being will create and become conscious of itself. It will realize that it is God. That's why the collectivists believe that there is a collective consciousness, because the collective creates a mystical consciousness which is higher than individual consciousness. They're basically fascist Power Rangers. We're all in our little zoids, and then we all come together to make a big megazoid, and then this new megazoid powers up and is like, yo bro, I'm God, and then we all win. And to confirm this, the swastika is the symbol of the sun god. You will find this symbol in India, you'll find it in ancient Troy, you will also find it in the north. And in Old Norse it was known as the sun wheel. It symbolizes the sun rolling across the heavens, but also Thor's hammer, lightning, Zeus, and that sort of thing. But basically, it's the power of the sun god. It also represents the Aryan race, which I've been over before, so I won't go into that again. But what I will talk about is someone I've mentioned previously in my Aryan religion video, Guido von List.
The connection between Volkish thought and the swastika, however, took another vital step forward in 1907. After reading the German translation of Blavatsky's Secret Doctrine, the Viennese mystic Guido List found that his visions began to take on a more recognizable theosophical form. He had already been fascinated by the swastika, but now also by what he believed were the uniquely Germanic reflexes of the Aryan symbol, the runes. Blinded for most of 1902 by an operation to remove cataracts, the next year the first of his purely occult studies appeared in the obscurantist journal Gnosis. Oh, tick. There's no evidence that National Socialism is Gnosticism. I think you'll find you're wrong. One of the originators of National Socialism is Guido von List, and he's writing for the journal Gnosis. This is concrete proof that National Socialism is a denomination of Gnosticism. And I think we've got enough evidence now to close this case. But anyway. Soon, his mystical teaching would crystallize into a more or less coherent doctrine. In 1907, as Guido von List, he published his account of the mystical powers of the Germanic Aryan runes, and single-handedly founded runic mysticism.
And by the way, this is where Himmler's side of the ideology comes from, as well as the Thule Society. So at the very least, Himmler is involved with this stuff, and obviously Hitler is in with him and the party itself, which was founded by members of the Thule Society. So to somehow conclude that it's not related is wrong. There's enough evidence here now. But to go back to the fascists, they want to get all their Zords together to form this organic state megazord thing, and
this goal can only be achieved with a special kind of social structure, one that does not permit for the individualist free-for-all, nor the collectivist clan-class-group conflicts.
We can't form Megazord if we're all in conflict, so we have to learn to come together like hippies in a field. We have to all be friends. But notice, he actually says, we can't be individualist, but we also can't be collectivist, because that makes conflict. Well, these guys are all about races, which separates us into different conflicting groups. So how can we all come together into one race if we're all against each other? Well, they have a final solution to that problem, don't they? They will get rid of everyone that they don't think belongs to their race so that we can all come together into one big Zord.
That structure is socialism, as social order. This is not economic socialism, but socialism that exists on par with, and in opposition to, individualism and collectivism by placing upon the people a sense of duty, which removes the elements of interest inherent to these two social structures, defining them as quantitatively the same, and placing our socialism as quantitatively different. Exactly. It's inappropriate to talk about any kind of third paths when in practice there are only two, good English bro.
So now he's saying they're not third positionists, which is interesting, but what they're doing is saying communism and capitalism are both individualist, and therefore the same thing, which is false, but that's what they're saying. So then they say that they themselves are bringing individualism and collectivism together into one, which is the same thing, and somehow meant to be different from normal socialism, you know, just because. And then saying that this will place upon the people a sense of duty with a capital D. Can you figure out who it is we have this sense of duty to? Oh, that's right, the true God, the organic state, the Megazoid.
Socialism as social order likewise undermines, through its introduction of duty, the fundamental premise of both capitalism and communism, who seek the same ends by different means, whereas our socialism disregards those ends, and likewise burdens economics with the same duty that it burdens the people in the social structure.
So, people are going to be burdened by duty to the true God, which is what they think will sort everything out. But why is being burdened by duty a good thing? It doesn't sound good, does it? You know, instead of working for your own benefit, I have to instead work for some random god for a sense of duty, even though it doesn't benefit me? Like, it's slavery. At least with Christianity, you get the promise of heaven after you die. You don't get that here. Instead, you get told, when God is awoken, we will all transcend. So, like, the ego loses its consciousness, we all lose ourselves, and we end up as nothing but a slave of the Megazoid. It doesn't make me interested at all. Like, socialism doesn't work, and I don't want any of this nonsense. So, there's no appeal at all. They even said that there's no material wealth. There is literally no incentive at all except this sense of duty to the true God. And even if it was possible to do this, it's pointless. It doesn't benefit us at all.
This socialism had a variety of names to help distinguish it from economic socialism. Authoritarian Prussian German socialism as opposed to English socialism, Oswald Spengler. Socialism of political imperialism, Francis Parker Yockey. Aryan socialism as opposed to Semitic socialism, Evola. Spartan socialism, Eduardo Velasco. Or just the socialism of national socialism. The definitive aspect of socialism as social order is that it necessitates adherence to duty, which removes petty individual interests entirely, thus negating individualism and collectivism as rival social structures, and subsequently negating capitalism and communism as economic forms in their purity. This socialism of duty, by necessity, has to figure out and develop one's personhood to understand his place in the social order, thus also realizing his place in the cosmic order. By that same necessity, socialism of duty prevents individual and group conflict by removing the kind of infighting that would tear at the social order. The organic state is called that because it is like a living organism, with cells and organs, and in a healthy organism, neither cells, individuals, nor organs, collectives, fight each other. A kidney can't engage in a struggle against the heart because they have inherently different purposes to which they are duty-bound. Thus, there is no room for conflict between them, no room for jealousy, no room for interests.
Ah yes, I remember that in biology class, you know, the bit where cells and organs operate in a sense of duty. Remind me how this is the science again. And newsflash, we're not kidneys. We are not cells of the body. Cells live and die and do so without thoughts. We are Homo sapiens, wise apes. At least some of us are. We have intelligence, wisdom, wants and needs, relationships and so on. And we are, and require more than, cells of the body. And I understand that they're trying to look for a higher purpose and meaning in life, but that this is not it. Whether God exists or not is not relevant to this point, which is that while you're on this earth, the purpose of life is to live it. Develop skills, go to work, earn enough to satisfy your wants and needs, procreate, have a bit of leisure time, pursue hobbies and interests, and just try and make the best of it before you're dead. And if God does exist, you go to heaven, and he'll reveal to you the grand plan. Or maybe you'll come back as a cow, or maybe you'll just be fertilizer, whatever. Regardless, your purpose is to make the most of it. It's not to create organic states of cosmic order and duty, it's not to rearrange society as if it's some sort of Sims game. And I understand that this is your religion, this is your belief system, but come on guys, this is completely unrealistic. There's a difference between going to church on Sunday and attempting to form the Megazord. So you're ruining it, you're ruining everybody else's lives over this nonsense.
Socialism as a social order, socialism of duty, thus also necessitates the formation of hierarchy, removing the falsehood of equality, and it affects every member of that hierarchy from top to bottom, as everyone are duty-bound to their role within the organic state and in the cosmic order. It's everyone is duty-bound, not everyone are duty-bound. Basic English, please. when a person grows to understand his destiny in the Francis Parker Yockey sense of the word as potential, his role in the cosmic order, he is duty-bound to fulfill it, to strive for that personal truth which is a part of the ultimate truth.
Yeah, anyone who says that this isn't a religion is crazy. I mean, this is definitely a cult. And apart from cosmic order, duty-bound, personal truth, and as part of an ultimate truth, ultimate Zord, you also have destiny. Destiny is what? The idea that your path in life has been preordained. It's been planned out for you in advance by a higher power. And it's interesting because this particular higher power hasn't gained consciousness yet. So how has he planned this out, right? How do you have a destiny if your God is unconscious? It makes no sense even on its own terminology. But here's something else to consider. If I am aiming to get to the true God because of some sense of duty, then I'm doing it because I think my duty is to get to God. Thus, I'm doing this for selfish reasons. I'm doing it because I want to. It gives me purpose. It makes me feel like I'm superior to everyone else, blah, blah, blah. So this is not done for non-selfish reasons. You're doing it for your own pleasure. Therefore, this whole pyramid of nonsense collapses in and of itself because you're wanting to find your personal truth, so you're doing it for selfish reasons. Your self-interest of aiming for God is selfish in and of itself, and there's no getting around that.
Thus, he finds his place in the hierarchy of the organic state, fulfilling not only his own personal truth, but also the truth of everyone who fulfills that role, as part of that social strata, estate, caste.
So on top of everything else, now there's a caste system. You know, how is adopting Indian culture meant to save the West from degeneracy? Oh, that's right. Crickets.
Realization of that strata estate caste truth helps realize the bigger truth of the nation to which they all belong, which in turn realizes the racial truth, in turn realizing human truth at large, and each single one of those helps directly fulfill the ultimate truth, as well as through that buildup of other truths. This is the organic state, where everything is in harmony and builds up to a cohesive and organic existence. Again, when he says truth, he means God. So it's a dialectical hierarchy of gods stretching upwards towards the top god, just like what the ancients believed in. So this is no different than what Plato was talking about. This socialism of duty is often brought up with comparisons to the army, a militant brotherhood where everyone fulfills their role in order for the organism of the army to be healthy. Again, most humans are not army men. We don't operate like that. The army might be a brotherhood of duty-bound priests, but most of us don't subscribe to that, nor should we. And the brotherhood thing reminds me of what Joachim of Flora's priestly brotherhood was about. So this is another confirmation that it's Gnosticism. Economy likewise becomes subservient and duty-bound to the fulfillment of the organic state, working towards realization of all minor truths and the ultimate truth.
So, just like in communism, the economy is no longer subservient to the wants and needs of the individual. The individual is neglected as the resources go to feeding this organic state, a godlike monster that devours all. All hail Megazoid, we chant as we all starve to death.
Hence, in fascism, the primary defining aspect of economics is its subservience to the same common duty that affects all members of this social order. But who came up with this social order? The unconscious god? Clearly not. So this social order is totally artificial, because someone made it up. Economics cannot be a goal in of themselves, as that breeds individualism, pure capitalism, liberalism, and those in turn lead to the formation of collectivism and communism. So, there cannot be individuals. You will be wiped out, apparently, in the name of the organic state. Instead, economics must be a tool towards the fulfillment of duty and the realization of all truths in the organic state. So economics should fulfill God. And by the way, this is just a fancy way of saying state ownership of the means of production. Fascist economics is then economy made subservient to the nation, which is what marks them as socialistic. Though in actual economic terms, the actual system can be a variety of things, perhaps even a form of regulated capitalism, regulated to make it duty-bound to the organic state, the nation, the fulfillment of truth. Right, so it is socialism then. After all this qualifying, it's still socialism. Yes, we know it's distinct from Marxism, but this isn't some special new socialism. This is what socialism has always been. All property is subservient to the state. Social ownership and control of the means of production. You can write as much doublespeak and whatever as you want, the principle is still the same. Hence, the real meaning of socialism when defining fascist economics, socialism as any economic system being made subservient to the organic state, the nation, the fulfillment of truth. Yes, socialism has always been this. The economy subservient to the state. That's literally what it has always been. If you have a free market that's subservient to the state, it's no longer a free market. Right? State capitalism, whatever you want to call it, that's socialism. Social ownership of the means of production. This isn't just the case of fascism. This is any socialism.
And I understand that you're trying to make yourselves distinct from the Marxists, and I understand that they're trying to make themselves distinct from you and the Social Democrats and whatever else, but ultimately, you're not. You're all denominations of the same religion. You're all trying to form a mega collective that will transcend and become God. It's all the same. Yes, there are differences, but you all agree on the same fundamental principles. The personal truth you talk about is liberalism. The individual will become free once they've created God. It's the exact same liberalism of the left. There's no difference here, only in how it's justified and presented.
So then he gives us quotes from various authors, which is what the rest of the book is about. We'll come back to these in a second. And then he concludes, "So, when someone wants to talk about fascist economics, they need be simply told. Fascist economics is economics subjugated to the organic state and duty-bound to nourish it, its cells and organs, so that they too might fulfill their own respective duties and realize their place in the cosmic order." Again, that's what socialism has always been. There's no difference here, except the words they use to describe it. But let's just look at some of the quotes he gives. "But to socialism, money possession is not the determinant of rank in society any more than it is in an army. Social rank in socialism does not follow money, but authority. Thus, socialism knows no classes in the Marxian capitalistic sense. It sees the centre of life in politics, and has thus a definite military spirit in it. Instead of classes, the expressions of wealth, it has rank, the concomitant of authority." Why would you use that word?
You're not getting rid of class. Race is a class. You see class distinctions, just not economic ones. They're racial ones. And if you actually read Marx's literature, you will find that when they say the capitalists, they mean Jews. The workers are the Aryans, and I've been over this in another video. You are not saying anything different than the Marxists are. You're just dressing it up in a different shade of red. And on page 11, in the section where he's quoting from Oswald Spengler, he talks about socialist man being turned into a military formation marching duty-bound to fight a war for a transcendent principle, the ultimate truth. Again, spiritual Gnosticism trying to get to the transcendent real God.
He quotes from Otto Strasser, "Socialism is an officer's corps. Socialism is the Cologne Cathedral. Socialism is the walls of the old imperial capital. Socialism of duty, a duty to a higher purpose, a task to be done, from the smallest task of one individual to the task of his guild, his caste, estate, to the task of the nation, the task being the adherence to the respective truths, and thus the ultimate truth of the cosmic order." Yeah, definitely spiritual, definitely Gnostic.
When quoting from Eduardo Velasco, the case is made that Sparta became socialist and totalitarian. So I guess all of the Marxists who hate me and who say that I said that ancient Rome was socialism, which I didn't, must be crying into their champagne right now, since it turns out that Sparta was real socialism, apparently.
Spartan phalanx, socialist institution to the core. Oh wow, socialism is when ancient Greek phalanx. And I guess the spear is the weapon of choice of the fascist megazoid. He then quotes from Julius Evola. In reality, however, there is an individualism which contains within itself, in the values of fidelity, service and honour, the seeds of the overcoming of the isolation and egoism of the individual, and renders possible a tranquil and sound hierarchical organisation. Neither the Romans nor the primordial Aryan Roman stocks needed to wait for Christian socialism before they could reach real, higher forms of organisation. On the one hand, there is Aryan socialism, the warrior ideal of an association of free masters. And on the other, there is the Semitic, ambiguous, totemic, unmanly socialism based on mutual dependency and pathos, something we would not know what to do with, and which we consider a disgrace to the European soul.
So, Christian socialism is Semitic, according to Evola. Thus, why would National Socialists be Christians, if Jesus and Christianity were bound up with the Jews? Then they wouldn't. So again, this is proof that this isn't Christianity or a Christian heresy, like some authors believe.
In total, one can hardly deny what socialism is, as practiced by fascists and National Socialists. Whoa, whoa, whoa! Notice the distinction? Fascists and National Socialists. Two separate ideologies. They are not one and the same, and I wish more people would recognise this. In total, one can hardly deny what socialism is, as practiced by fascists and National Socialists. Not an economic system, but a social order, necessary for the formation of the organic state. One that subjugates economy to duty before the nation, and one that elevates every man to reach his potential and share in common joy of duty to the cosmic order.
Socialism is when the Megazord does stuff. So, what can we learn from all of this? Well, obviously, there's clear elements of Gnosticism in here. It's obviously a religion, it's a cult, and it's all about transcendence. I do wonder what the third positionist YouTuber I can't name would think about this text, because it contradicts what he says in his videos. It also contradicts other fascists and National Socialists that I've read as well, so I don't think that this is a united ideology. There are factions within the overall religion, and it seems to be splintered. I do think Evola has left his mark here. It appears to be a corrupted version of fascism with racial elements lumped on the side. The race elements seem less important than what you would otherwise see in National Socialist literature, and while they have adopted the swastika, they don't really seem to understand what National Socialism is, or if they do, they're leaning away from it. So I would say that this piece was written by racist Evola fascists rather than actual fascists or National Socialists. If it wasn't for the fact that this group had killed people, or that we know that Julius Evola was a nutjob, I'd even go so far as to say that this was fake. So while it's similar and has been influenced by them, it's not traditional fascism and it's not traditional National Socialism. If this is a genuine representation of modern fascism and National Socialism, and not just this group in isolation, then modern fascists and Nazis have veered in a very strange direction. Either way, they're clearly not for free markets. They haven't read the literature, and they're ignorant of how economics works. And it's interesting how 80 years after the war, they're still trying to distinguish themselves from the left. Like, oh no, theirs isn't normal socialism, it's a socialism of duty, which is exactly what Marxist socialism is. Like, Marxists want to abolish money, and then we all just slave for the social organism, the state. That's exactly what the fascists want too. So it's interesting how they're still trying to distinguish themselves, which suggests that they have a lot more in common than they'd like to admit. The YouTuber I mentioned also had to qualify that they were socialists, but not socialists of the Marxist variety, saying that Marxists were liberals, whereas fascists are not. Again, if that's the only difference, then there's hardly any difference at all. Overall, though, there is some good news. Unlike the Marxists, modern fascists haven't really evolved any new strategies. They're just the same as they were in Evola's time. The Marxists are now for the blacks and the lesbians, even though they're not. You guys are just pawns in the power struggle, and you've fallen for it. But the fascists and Nazis haven't changed. So this is actually good, because it's unlikely that the majority of the population will be stupid enough to fall for their religion in the future. Some obviously have fallen for it, and we can't be complacent, but it's unlikely to be as popular as it once was. And everyone who's watching this needs to be aware that these are cults. Marxism, fascism, Nazism, whatever. These are cults, and they will drag us down to hell if we're not vigilant against them. I'm holding this up for a reason. This, you know, it's relevant to this point. All this talk about truth, cosmic truth, absolute truth, all this preaching against material wealth and the European soul, it all has a religious essence to it. You can imagine them standing on the pulpit, preaching to the masses, telling them not to engage in acts of degeneracy. They share the same hatred of selfishness and the self that other religions do. You didn't achieve anything, you didn't raise your children, God did. So you can't be proud of yourself or your children, because they're not yours, they're God's. They are God's children, they are God's achievements, not yours. And by God, they mean the state. It's no different than what Plato was on about a couple of millennia ago. They are coming for your children, literally. My policy is to convert people away from the cult by exposing this nonsense. And I know that I have succeeded in the past. Former Nazis and fascists have thanked me for making them realise that they had fallen for this. So if there are any fascists or whatever watching this, and you realise that you need to get out, I understand that you're going to be shamed for doing so by society at large, you know, for being former fascists. But you need to get out. Your comrades might hate you and might want to drag you back in, but you need to get out. And if you are a former fascist, I mean, I won't shame you. Society might, but I won't. Right? I'd rather have a former fascist than a real one. And maybe we need something like Alcoholics Anonymous, like Fascism Anonymous, where people can go and get help. And I'm actually kind of serious here. That actually might be something to set up. But, it can't be run by leftists or whatever. It needs to be done properly. Anyway, I'm going to leave it there, guys. Check out my other videos on fascism and Nazi ideologies. And thanks for watching. Bye for now.